So there isn't really a true right way to model something, but I can remember it being the main thing that would stop me making something in 3D. So for example, is it okay for me to transition from a boxy shape to a cylindrical shape by just sitting a cylinder right on top of a box? Spoiler alert, yes. Taking a really simple cup as an example, let's make a handle for it, which goes from about here to here as an exercise, and why you might choose one modeling method over the other. Here we'll go E to extrude, move each extrusion, simple rotating. It's pretty rough, but it's also pretty easy. Join it back to the cup with a bridge edge loops operation, and we're done. It's low poly, so it's easy to adjust. We can let the subdivision surface modifier do most of the heavy lifting when it comes to smoothing it out. Finally, we can right click and shade smooth to complete the illusion. If we don't want such a gradual soft join from the cup to the handle, then we just add extra edge loops close to the cup. Here's a simpler extrusion from the cup, but making more use of the bridge tool. I'm going to delete the faces this time around and just work with the edges. Copy the edges from one of the holes we've made and rotate from an orthographic camera view and place them roughly into the middle of where we want the furthest part of the handle to be. Then select the three sets of edge loops and then use the bridge tool. For a curvier handle, we can up the number of cuts and adjust the smoothness to get it just how we want. This time, let's try using the spin tool. Select the face we want to start from, enable the spin tool, make sure we set the correct axis. In this example, that's the y-axis. The tool will spin around the position of the 3D cursor so we can adjust the position of that by shift right clicking. Click and drag on the plus to spin out that geometry. After the fact, you can adjust the segments to make it smoother or the center of what we're spinning around to fine tune the position. Then just connect it up any way you like. Here, I'm just going to finish it off with the bridge tool. With the methods so far, if we decide to change the handle position or size later on, it's a little trickier. As long as we don't mind a harsh transition, we can break out the primitives. For example, a torus should work fine. Again, let the subdivision surface modifier do the heavy lifting on the smoothing side of things. If we want to change the thickness, we can just use Alt-S to shrink or fatten it to taste. To get rid of the extra parts of the torus inside the cup, we could simply add loops and delete the faces we don't want. But then we give up some of the flexibility of moving it if we deleted too much. So instead, we could use a Boolean modifier. First, I'll undo that and separate the torus into a separate object. For our Boolean object, I'll duplicate the cup and enter edit mode on it. I just want the inside faces, so I'll select the bottom and grow the selection to the top rim. But it's a little hard to see, so I'll hide the original cup in the outliner. Then I'll just invert the selection and delete all those faces. Flip the normals. And then to make it a solid object, just go to the mesh menu and choose convex hull. Then shift select the handle to add it to our selection. And then with the bool tool add-on enabled, we can just use control and minus on the numpad to subtract the cup shape from the torus shape. The Boolean object I'll now move to a collection of its own called bool. Rename the separate handle object, unhide the original cup so we can parent the Boolean object to it. Now, however we choose to scale or move the handle, we won't see it on the inside of the cup. For completeness, I'll parent the handle to the cup too, and then hide the bool collection. Another option is to use a separate floating curve instead of a floating torus. Just add in a curve Bezier object. Then from a couple of different orthographic views, move, scale, and rotate the points and their handles just how you want them. We can also select all the points on the curve and right-click to subdivide to add another point in the middle if we need even more control over the shape. Turn up the bevel depth to a decent thickness and set the resolution along the curve here and the resolution for the bevel going around the curve up at the top here. We can line up our curve bevel geometry here by setting the tilt to 45, or we can do that with the Ctrl-T shortcut. Thickness can again be controlled with Alt-S. An individual point can even have its own radius separate to everything else, so there's a decent amount of control there. Even with curves, we can throw on a subdivision surface modifier. Then I'll just parent the curve to the cup. There's another way we can create our curves, and that's just to simply draw them in. First, delete the existing curve vertices, then change to the draw tool, then just left-click and drag the shape you want, and it's as easy as that. I haven't quite drawn this in the right position though, so I'll just correct that from the top view and then fine tune it from the front. If we like working with the curves to get the initial shape, but we still want that smooth connection we got with the meshes, then we can just line up the faces by setting the amount of faces we want and then tilt them to an angle of 45, then just right click and convert it to a mesh. Delete the unneeded faces and join the handle to the cup object with Ctrl J. then use the bridge tool as we did before. For a way to work with meshes that look a bit like curves, we can create our basic handle shape with just verts and edges. I'll start with a duplicate of the faces where I'd roughly like the handle to join the cup, separate them as a separate object, merge each face to the center so that we just have the vertices where the middle of the faces were. Then we can create the vertices and edges to define the shape. Then using a skin modifier, which goes before the subdivision surface modifier, it's going to give us that sort of curve result, which we'll see in a moment. First, let's just control the size. We can do that with Control A, and then we can enable our subdivisions to get a nice amount of smoothing happening. This time we don't need to worry about trying to tilt the geometry to line up, and when adjusting the size of each individual point, we have access to separate axes, so we can make it much wider than it is tall, for example. Then I'll just parent the handle to the cup and we're done. There's other modeling tools to explore that can help us with this kind of thing. For example, if we get a copy of the faces that run along the height of the handle and then collapse them into an edge and dissolve the vertices in between, we can then use the Edge Roundifier from the Edit Mesh Tools add-on. We'll find this by going Control E, Edge Roundifier. This creates the sort of shape we need, though we do need to change a few settings here. The plane in this case needs to be YZ. We can smooth out the curve by adding some more segments. We don't need the original edge, so we can set that to remove. Then we need to rotate that edge right around to align it better. And I'll go with negative 90 at first. We can also use the elliptical factor to adjust the profile. From the top view, it looks like I need to rotate it a bit further. Then I can scale and rotate it where I want it. And then we're free to separate it as a separate object. And then as we did before, we can skin it, adjust the size of the vertices, and then when happy, we can apply the skin modifier, combine the handle together with the cup, delete the excess faces, and then bridge the connections for it to all be nicely smooth. Another way to combine the curve and mesh workflows together, but to give us a lot more mesh editing options, is to use a curve to create the handle shape, and then a separate mesh that can deform along that curve. That separate mesh object we need to make sure is created with the same origin as the curve, the little orange dots in other words, and we need enough loops along the mesh. Then parent the mesh to the curve and choose Curve Deform. This sets up the modifier for us. Then we can move the mesh along the x-axis and it'll deform to our curve. We can smooth it up with the subdivision surface modifier, and we can also scale the mesh along the x-axis to have it match the length a bit better. The curve needs to be better aligned from the top view, so I'll scale everything down to zero on the y-axis and move it back to where it should be. Or we can just set the y-axis value in the sidebar to be zero to get it really accurate. Then we can fine-tune it by adjusting the curve and the position and scale of the mesh along the x-axis. The extra benefit here is we're still able to adjust the size of parts of the curve with Alt-S, and we're also able to work directly on the mesh. We just need to make sure all the buttons are enabled on the modifier to make it easier to see it in edit mode and to work on the cage itself. Another method would be to use geometry nodes, which opens another massive can of worms, so to speak, which we're just going to have to save for another time. Hi, this has been 80 Burrows for Creative Shrimp. I hope this video, although I know it does go by pretty quickly, I hope it helps to quell some of those modeling trepidations that you might have, that fear of starting to model something in the pursuit of perfection, that it has to be the fastest, the easiest, the least amount of clicks, leave behind the least amount of polygons, lets you iterate on the design easily, and hopefully is actually fun to do. Especially when starting out, all roads are going to take you to your destination, so it's important to just start and try a method. If there's any other methods that you think should have been included here, please let us know. And let us know how you're getting on in your computer graphics exploration in general. And until next time, cheers.